Good morning, everybody. Give me a minute to share. Can you see my screen?
Yes, ma'am. We can.
Okay. Very good. Thank you very much, Jaldeep, for a very long introduction. I don't know whether I'm worthy of it, but I'll try to make the most in the talk. So, the friends, today morning, we have challenges in QC and equi-year results in biochemistry, where each one of us has to put in our best. And we're doing it from a CAP perspective. CAP means College of American Pathologists. Now, we in Mumbai, that is, became the first hospital laboratory sometime in 2006 to be a CAP accredited laboratory. Some individual labs like SRL, etc., did exist. They did get their CAP earlier, but the hospital environment is very different from standalone labs. And it was a real challenge. And I introduce you all to it. So friends, what is quality? Quality per se, I'm not talking about the quality control. I'm talking about what is quality. It is the totality of characteristics of a product, which will bear an ability to satisfy the customer's requirements. Now, when we look at quality control, it will be the patient requirements. So if you see this, yeah, this is the quality aspect. Quality assurance is the second blue circle. It is a process. It is planned and systematic activities to provide adequate confidence that requirements for quality are being met. So that is quality assurance. And what is management? The last outer circle, it involves all activities of overall management function, which determine not only the quality policy objectives and responsibilities, but also make sure they are implemented by quality planning, quality control, quality assurance, and quality improvement. Closer to our lab testing, quality control is a method whereby the performance of analytical methods can be monitored and assessed by analysis of specimens which contain a known concentration of an analyte. So we all know that quality control has a known concentration of the analyte. It is known by us in the laboratory. And how do we monitor? We accept it or we reject it. So it is monitored, acceptable versus not acceptable. Needless to say, quality control has to be stable. It acts as a surrogate sample, as a specimen designed to simulate a patient sample. It simulates a patient sample for quality control purposes. The idea is to get the same result as has been predetermined. It is stable and we know that it has a known concentration. Now, quality control material is a specimen or a solution which is analyzed solely for the monitoring performance of a method. So you have a method for a chemistry, then you will monitor the quality, the control material is there. It is analyzed only for monitoring the method of that analyte. Please remember, never use controls for calibration purposes. Then you will have quality charts, control charts, which you are expected to do. So you have simple graphical displays in which you put the observed values versus the time when these observations were made. And needless to say that one should be, this is what ultimately leads to a Levy-Jennings chart. These are the limits of 1 SD. These are the limits of 2 SD. The control should always fall within 2 SD, never beyond. In fact, if it reaches 2 SD, that means it is a warning. And your QC data would be analyzed as per these rules. Now, if it violates these rules, then you would have to take a corrective action. Corrective action on errors, which could be random or which could be systematic. So what are random errors? Random errors are fluctuations, statistical fluctuations. They could be minus or they could be in plus, in either direction. And in the measured data, due to precision limitations of the measurement device, Systematic errors, on the other hand, are inaccuracies. Inaccuracies which are reproducible all the time. So you get into these kind of trends that are consistently in the same direction, and they are often due to a problem which is there during the entire experiment and every time. So what do the control rules detect? These are the control rules which are violated, and these are the type of errors that one should look for. Okay. Very slow. So there are quality control issues. For example, you have value shifting within the range. It would be a systematic error. So that could be either because of inadequate mixing of controls left at some optimal temperature for too long. So all these need to be looked into. If the values are shifting or they are out of range, it is again a systematic error. And any of these reasons described above or these that are enumerated have to be looked into. If it's a trend, it is an instrument change. So there is a reaction temperature that you would look at, sampling problem, reaction delivery problem, reagent delivery problem, etc., etc. So what does the quality control rule say? Now, this is the CLIA, which is formulated or mandated by the US FDA. And this is what? This is the Clinical Laboratory Improvement Act 1988. There have been various amendments. 92 was the last amendment. And this is what they say. And CLIA is adopted by CAP. CAP has to follow CLIA. So it puts up in its common checklist. Now, CAP has a series, I think over 3,000 questions. So, and each one has a number, like you see COM.40840. So 40840 is a specific question and it addresses general quality control. What does that say? Laboratory must establish and follow written quality control procedures for monitoring and evaluating the quality of the analytical testing process of every method that is done in the laboratory. Interestingly and importantly, CAP does an excellent job on, explaining how it is to be done. This is the rule. How would you go about doing it? CAP also tells you. If you go to the checklist, which are there on the site, you would be able to see how you would best manage it. Okay. So per run, it says, this rule says, per run, qualitative and quantitative test requirements are that you run two controls minimally every 24 hours. It should not exceed greater than 2 hours, all right? 24 hours, sorry. And if you do an electrophoretic determination, you should run one control per run, but it should not be greater than 24 hours. Now, these are the requirements by College of American Pathologists for quality control. So you have procedure manual, performance verification, maintenance function check, calibration, etc. And each of them is given under a clause, under the common checklist clause, and you can refer to them. All right. Now, important is that we need to review the QCs proactively. It does not mean that you do the QC, you don't look at what you get, and then you just write it, or you tick boxes. No, never. So we have to play a proactive role in the QC, which involves routinely assessing QC before a major event turns it into a QC failure and draw leadership's attention. The most important, and I emphasize on this, and all those who are leaders in the labs must acknowledge this. The first is the culture. It is our priority as leaders to make QC a priority. If we don't do it, others will, our technologists will not do it. The rest of the laboratory begins to prioritize it as well, only if the leader acknowledges it as a priority. Part of making QC a priority includes giving technologists a protected time to manage QC. It can't be done, you know, please do it, by the way, do it. It can't be. You have to give the technologists the time and a protected time that at this time to this time, you will do QC and nothing else. It's very important. Even in my own lab, sometimes it gets neglected, but this is extremely important. The second change is the potential to provide positive encouragement to personnel who are handling QC events. It is important to give them a positive feedback. Yes, you can say this was wrong and this was a negative feedback when there are poorly handled events, but more importantly, the positive encouragement has to be given, because then only the culture sets in. Because ultimately, the goal of proactive QC evaluation is to instill a culture which values QC and recognize it. And these laboratorians should view QC failures not as isolated events, but as global picture. QC events are viewed in isolation, neither investigated nor corrected, is a very bad practice. College of American Pathologists accredited laboratory is required to investigate proficiency testing failures thoroughly. It is mandatory. It is mandatory even for NABL, because NABL also has an EQUAS programs and also handles quality control very effectively and handles oversees it and monitors it very well. Then rarely, however, are such investigations undertaken for QC failures, even though unaddressed QC failures precedes many PT failures. Because if you let go of QC failure, it will become a PT failure. More importantly, what you would do is you would give a wrong report to the patient. Now, for example, you have unacknowledged 10X rule violation. Of the rules that I showed, 10X is one of those rules where all the points come in one direction, and this will eventually lead to unacceptable bias and will lead to a PT failure. In order to address these QC failures, before they become a PT failure, it is important to evaluate the QC trends rather than a single QC failure. A recurring QC failure requires prompt laboratory attention. Questions like, does the instrument in question needs to be calibrated more frequently? Maintenance schedule, should we adjust it or should we do something about it? Should we do it more number of times? Because you know, as the instrument ages, it requires more maintenance. Is the lab experiencing more failures at a particular time of day? These are some things that you need to address. CAP also gives the QC requirements for corrective action. The laboratory must, so those are given in this particular standard, and this is in the general checklist, and the laboratory must document all corrective actions that are taken, including actions taken when any of this happens. That is, results of control material, all of them fail, laboratory established criteria it's not falling within the acceptability criteria, all patient test results obtained in this, and since the last acceptable test run, have to be evaluated again to determine if the patient test result has been affected. We need to have a documentary evidence of this. We need to take a corrective action and to ensure that the reporting of accurate and reliable patient test results has taken place. If by chance you've given a report which was wrong because of the QC failure, which you did not see, you're expected to go back, run it properly, see what you got, make sure it is within the acceptable limits, call up the doctor and give him the correct result. It is very important to do that because it saves a patient. Employing all these three strategies should make labs management of QC events a very meaningful part of the culture and one that helps ensure that QC events will not go unreported. Now, this becomes sometimes very heavy for big labs, big hospitals, because the technologist is under a tremendous pressure. And so major vendors have now offered functionalities by introducing middleware applications, which handles all the QC aspects. It is good. These middleware are important. They help a lot. But still, I think the most important is the culture in the laboratory, which values QC management, meaningful QC management, and the attitude of checking off QC number, type, frequency is not what you really want. Control failure probably is one of the terrible ones. Single control point failure represents either a random error, but if it happens continuously, when simple reevaluation of control material fails to show that the method is in control, when you do it twice, thrice, and you find that you're not getting the controls in this, corrective action needs to be done. What would you do? You would do a recalibration. A fresh reagent, maybe you look for, new reagent lot you would ask for. And then lastly, you would go for a new control material. Control materials are generally expected to be stable and they don't deteriorate. But sometimes it does happen that it continues to fail even after repeated calibration. So verification of that is a problem and requires comparison testing. So you need to test it and compare it with previously assayed patient samples you'll have to take out and run, previous proficiency testing material, alternate lot calibrators, comparison with alternate instruments. It's a long thing. Identification of the problem. Once you identify this is a control which has gone wrong, it raises two situations. Either you wait for a new control material, and you establish an acceptable range for the new control material when it arrives, or because concurrent testing, that means of the old control and the new control is not possible, and send the test out until the new quality material, control material is verified by the laboratory. Within run mean of several replicates, historic ranges based on the old control material, daily monitoring, frequent re-evaluation of statistics, all this needs to be, it is a long process and waiting for monthly statistics is not very timely. However, if you do that, you need to document all these. Results released since the last valid set of quality control must be evaluated with documentation. Batch assays, you would repeat the entire batch, repeat the selected patients from the failed batch to evaluate whether the patient samples were affected. Select patients within the entire span or the range of the results from the failed run. Select patients now become your controls for the failed run, which you will recheck. The documentation of the failed run must include the repeat results from a successful run. Then only the documentation is complete. When it comes to the analytical system, each of the situation raises uncertainty about the reliability of the results up to the last valid QC. So unexpected system failures, corrective action must include verifying the patient results in question. It is important to double check on the patient results. System failures can be handled in a very organized manner, running controls prior to implement any new investigation, corrective action, and the run to be closed down with documentation of the validity of the patient prior patient results. Now, if you do a monthly review, it is important to do a monthly review and it has to be done by the leadership. Controls may be evaluated by the same method used for the current QC failure, but done retrospectively. Comparison of patient means, evaluation of deltas, correlation with clinical findings. And if you find evidence of a problem with the run, the laboratory and laboratory alone has the responsibility of notifying the clinical services and offering remedy to it. So this would be a little late, and it would not be that you would be able to reconstruct what the problems occurred at that time. If you ran three levels of QC, the portion of analytical range, which is spanned between two adjacent valid QC samples, is to be considered in control. So you should basically get your results within these three QCs. that is within this span. Accept the patient results between these two adjacent QC results. But if you have something which goes beyond your quality control ranges, then hold that sample outside this range, dilute it, whatever it is, and repeat it. Repeat representatives, accepted samples on the next run. Peer group monitoring is an important aspect of quality control. Here, the outside provider, companies actually, they obtain laboratories data in real time and aggregates of it. All over the world, they take it and aggregates of it with other users to provide ongoing assessment of the comparability of the control results across the peer laboratories. And this is done in real time, and they give you an access to that. So supposing you have a QC, which we had actually, and where the control results were coming low, and we checked entire system, but we could not detect anything. Last thing we did is we looked at the peer group, and sure enough, the control year was lower. You know, that put us at ease that everything else was okay. But it's an important aspect. Continuous proficiency testing, avoid such isolated events from the traditional proficiency testing. So this is like a peer group monitoring is like continuous proficiency testing. So if your provider is providing it, by all means, access it and use it. It gives more rapid assessment of the current status of the method. The program will provide a comparison which will help to verify the stability and comparability of the in-house method when you compare it. It will act to monitor a potential performance. A deviation from this statistics does not necessarily mean that the method is out of control. Comparison does not remove the requirement by no means for daily and monthly in-house review. Peer statistics will not substitute for current in-house acceptance criteria. It is something that is to be done additionally, but not only. QC requirements of corrective actions. The laboratory must document all corrective actions taken. Result of control and calibration materials. If they both fail to meet the laboratory's criteria for acceptability, all patient test results obtained in that unacceptable run and since the last acceptable run have to be evaluated. Why? To determine if the patient test result was affected. The laboratory will take a corrective action necessary to ensure the reporting of the accurate and reliable patient results. By all means, keep it documented. If there was a major QC failure, what you would do is you would repeat the control cup, pour fresh control rerun, make up new control vials and run. If all this has not rectified, it is an instrument problem which needs an interaction by the supervisor. Check the calibration records, recalibrate if it is necessary, check your reagents, put fresh reagents. If you've done all this, it's time to call the biomed engineer. Get them on the hotline for a hardware troubleshooting recommendations, whatever, and they should do the rest. They should give you a backup. There are times when you need help. You have to get it. The QC policy will tell you, your hospital or lab's QC policy will tell you what help to get, when to get. If the people you need aren't available, there has to be someone who is covering for it. That provision is also to be made in your QC policy. Now, this is a CAP document which talks about the quality control and what you need to do and how you can show that you have done it. So you can refer to that. These are the common random errors that you get. These are the common causes of systematic errors. And you would have to go through each one of them, check it out if you get an error. And this brings us to the second part of our talk, and that is proficiency testing or EQAS. So what is proficiency testing? Proficiency testing by CAP is an educational tool. What it involves is you subscribe to it, you pay money for it, and these are expensive. It and there are other e-courses available as well, and which NABL has agreed. So PT is also educational and involves sending samples with results unknown to the laboratory. So they send you samples in proper dry ice or whatever, you know, however it needs to be transported. The results are unknown to the laboratory. How often do they send it? They send it 3 times a year, generally. If it is out of the way PT, then you may only get 2 cycles. Or once in a while, we've also received 1 cycle if you're doing something which is out of the ordinary. So you go ahead and you evaluate it, all right? You run it and you submit the results. Once you submit the results, they would evaluate it. There is a certain timeline given. So you they evaluate whether the laboratory's results are accurate and they compare it to the peers. The CAP regulation requires that the PT samples be tested in the same manner as the patient sample. That means they would have to be accessioned, they would have to be, and the tech need not even know that it's a PT sample. That is the true way of doing it. PT samples are provided. Who provides this? That's an important question. There's an organization which is called as a CMS, which is itself monitored and which is under a regulatory review, and they provide to CAP. These are also provided by some non-profit organization and agencies which are affiliated to state as well as the federal. Now, the first PT program started somewhere in the 40s. But then, since then, it has become a very important and essential component of the quality management system in the laboratories. And it is compulsory for labs which are accredited, be it CAP accredited, where PT is acquired, or NABL, where also a proficiency testing is a must. It is so in many countries, including India. Because laboratory test reports are released from processes which meet the specifications, and evaluation reveals whether the unacceptable results by PT providers need to be looked into. So the laboratory, if you get an unacceptable PT, you would investigate the causes of error, correct the procedure that leads to PT failures, eliminate the chance of happening it again. An outcome of the reasons of the PT failure can be used by the laboratory. It is also useful by the manufacturers. There have been reasons and instances where we have passed these PT problems to the manufacturers, and sometimes even to the PT providers themselves in improving their products and service. There is a complete document by CAP on what to do with proficiency testing failure, and the reference is given underneath. So, how do they do a PT value? How do we do? There is an ongoing evaluation of PT and alternate assessment. Now, we don't do alternative assessment for regulated air analytes, but it requires a prompt corrective action taken for unacceptable results. The key point is to investigate each unacceptable PT result and provide corrective action that is appropriate to the failure. Now, this is, and it is taken from the same reference that I showed you. This is a survey which was taken for 2015 proficiency testing comparison. It is done by CAP itself. And this on the left side is the average percentage correct of the total graded challenges. So total graded challenges in various sections of the laboratory. So you'll see most of the sections were 95% or above 95% correct for the various challenges, except for maybe something can be done, mycobacteria, mycology, parasitology. They really, the labs need to gear up and perfect this. That is what it is. Now, what when you get an unacceptable PT, what does it mean? It means you develop a process, you investigate and avoid this performance. this failure. So every unacceptable PT result that you get needs to be looked into. You monitor the performance of each. Now, every event that it went through, it's difficult, but we have to do it. Every event, and over time, looking for trends, major categories of investigation are these. So we need to go through it step by step. Major categories are clerical, analytical, procedural, specimen handling, and PT material. These are the five major groups. Now, if it was clerical error, it is easy. You will get this checklist at this website. Clerical, it could be a transcription error, correct method. So if you know it's a clerical error, it is easy. It could be any of these. Procedural, reagent preparation. So you would have to visit this event. Reagent preparation, reagent acceptable. If it was a histopathology, staining, interpretation steps. Analytical, then calibration, stability, persistent bias, was it or was it not? So you would naturally refer to the quality control aspects, whether it was always within measuring range, the maintenance of the instrument, whether this is, which is the most neglected part, problems, QC, calibration review need to be addressed. Coming to specimen handling, reconstitute the PT samples according to instructions. Now, this is something that needs a good handling. Storage per instruction, perform correct tests on correct vial, follow the specific kit instructions. Most importantly, and very often, blood gas sample handling is a common problem and results in PT failure, which is very bad because if in a hospital, if you have more than two blood gas machines and if you are doing a PT and you are asked to cease testing, it means you stop testing on both the equipment, which can be fatal for the hospital. So you have to be very, very careful in handling a blood gas sample. PT material, whether we received, this is the last one, I think, PT material, whether it is received on time or in good condition. Now, when you review the PT results, your own results, you need to check for persistent bias, trends and shifts, need to address it. Change in the system and process. If there was a systematic error, look into those aspects that we've outlined and rectify it. Evidence of corrective action. You need to document that. It also becomes a training opportunity for the techs and ourselves to learn because we learn from them. For example, in interference, when we looked at, we used to get, this is just to break the monotony. We used to get, we have many bypass patients, as you know. And from the ICU, we used to get samples for creatinine early morning. That was a routine, okay? We noticed that creatinines in the morning from the ICU were always low. Later on, maybe after 2-3 hours, if you took a second sample, all those creatinines would be what they were the previous day. This set us thinking, what could that be? We did a lot of event investigation on what happens in the ICU before the blood is drawn. And when we did that, we were so surprised that all of these were given cephalosporins. This was some years ago. It was a routine to give that. And the blood was taken after that. Then, because the clinicians, as you know, will always come back and fight with you saying you are giving wrong creatinine results. So we worked very hard on it, but we came to a conclusion and we found documentary evidence that cephalosporin interferes with our creatinine assays. First, the clinicians refused to believe this, but we gave them documentary evidence. That was the end of it. So it becomes a training opportunity. We also didn't know. Then the staff competency. Staff also becomes better and better competent at handling these. Now, this is a snapshot of a PT results that have sent to us. This is not ours, but if you see for SGOT or AST, there were five challenges which were sent. Out of that, four were acceptable, but one was unacceptable. The result was 75, mean was 101, and these were the SDs. Okay, number of labs which gave the correct result were 518. Okay, so if you see it on this chart, then this particular result shows that it has exceeded the limits. Okay, so result is outside the acceptable limit. Same thing with PO2, which, as I said, is most labile. You'll see that of the 5 challenges, 4 are unacceptable. And this, you can see, have gone beyond limits, which needs to be looked into. So you will check step by step what went wrong. It could be the membrane. It could be the something must be interfering. But then that affects patient results. So these are categories. A survey was done by NCCLS, and the reference is given over here. Is sponsored. This was sponsored by NCCLS for routine chemistry PG programs. You will not be able to see it, but the next few slides tell you more about it. So basically, it broke. You could break all this entire survey into 5 categories. The clerical. These were the causes of unacceptable PTs. So clerical. Out of the 802 unacceptable clerical results, which formed 10.2% of the results, reasons, 466 were transcription errors. That means 5.9%. So on and so forth. Methodological, the subgroup, when you give a reason for why your PT failed and what you did after it. So there were problems in manufacturing of the reagents or the reference material. And that is why there was this unacceptable result, which accounted for 7.4% of the 16% of the reasons given for methodological variations. Equipment, which I said is something that we need to look into, and that is, or unacceptable results were 1,859. And 23.6% of all these reasons accounted for the unacceptable results. And which was the topmost? Failure to adhere to scheduled instrument maintenance procedures, which formed 19.5% of all the reasons why the PT failed. Now, this is very important. We all tend to neglect the maintenance because it is not convenient to us. All of us do that, but it is something that we should avoid. We should have a regular maintenance. Maybe we should go to a backup analyzer. Technically, 37% of all the reasons cited of the unacceptable results for 2,949 PTs. And calibration problem, expired calibration curve, calibrator were the main things. Then, inappropriate peer group, because you need to identify who is your peer group. So that was wrongly identified. And unexplained, 0.5%. Now, that is something that we need to look further into. It does not mean that it is something to be left in air. So the 3 main reasons for unacceptable PT was failure to adhere to instrument maintenance, management problems for the reagent, and these can be corrected fundamentally. So all these 3 need to be looked into. Many unacceptable results were unexplained because statistically PT grading determines PT failures. But if you have a proper laboratory records, it will help the laboratory to reconstruct what happened for during that PT performance. And you can say why this became unacceptable. So the reports of some participants that their PT failure was unexplained results because of an inability to reconstruct what happened when analyzing the PT samples. I think I should hurry up. Okay, so what can the laboratory scientists use this information to help the laboratory investigate PT failures? These are the few things which we've already talked about, and you will get this PT exception investigation worksheet also on the site. So you could use that. And if one suspects that the problems are generated by the PT provider, it is, if you feel that it is the PT provider who where the problems are. It is the PT which is this, that it's incumbent on the laboratory to inform the PT provider, as we had done. We had a problem with our flow PT, flow cytometer PT, and we always got it degraded. So we had to inform them, and they exempted us from that because many people had complained. Documentation, of course, is required to assess the effectiveness. And if the documentation, is not sufficient, then the CAP will ask laboratory for additional documentation. I briefly touch on Q-probes, Q-tracks. I don't have to do it, but I'll just introduce you and then maybe you all could take it further. Now, in somewhere in 89, CAP introduced the Q-probe program by which we define the nature of quality in practices of laboratory medicine. So what CAP did is it collected data over a limited period of time, generally 1 to several months. This data was calculated. They gave it to the laboratories. Laboratories filled that up and calculated the benchmarks of laboratory performance. Participants provide general information, and each laboratory is different. So it will have its own characteristics, and this will be, which is, it will have its own characteristics, and therefore, the laboratory practices are determined and they are associated with better or worse performance. So when they analyze that, they could tell us whether it was a good performance or a bad performance. Also, we come to know whether all labs follow that in the world or there is something different that we can adopt. Study formats were developed, college collected this data, current practices, addresses all phases of the testing cycle and gives recommendations, and it will give a measurable improvement against the peer activity. These are open to subscribers and which is paid. So many of us don't do it, but we just read through and we create ours. You can go through in the literature, and also this is identified for development by CAP committees which sit on it. It is a snapshot in time. As I have said, I think I already talked more than what I have. Individual data provides all that I did. Then it also, CAP also launched Q-track programs. Now Q-track program is a long program. It does tracking improvement of deterioration in performance, and it goes over sometimes a month. Data is collected the same way, protracted periods of time, usually years. And it gives its own sheets, and you have to give a feedback. Feedback meaning you have to break up the entire process which you've taken up into small, small units, and it will be checked. And participants can compare their performances to whatever is the national benchmark. These are the advantages previously in Q-probe studies and to those to the peers who have chosen to participate. It's a moving picture. It will monitor the performance over time. Quarterly, you have to do a data submission. A single primary performance is the indicator which is monitored, and there are various other secondary indicators also which are monitored. Quarterly, the data analysis is done, trended over time, and annual summary report is given. These are the various, in the various sections where Q-probes and Q-tracks have been undertaken. They're all on the website, and it is through the entire test cycle. Test cycle, which takes care of the turnaround time, satisfaction of the patient, diagnostic performance, efficiency, safety. CAP lays a lot of stress on safety, safety of the patient, safety of the personnel who do the testing, accuracy, ordering, testing, reporting. All these are Q-probes. Information systems, errors, competence, nursing satisfaction, whether the nurse is happy with the laboratory service, technical staffing, manual peripheral blood smear, how good have they been? Patient identification, culture, contamination, all these. Turnaround times, a big thing. Critical value reporting, very important. Surgical specimens, turnaround time. Wherever there have been problems, they've taken up this problem and done it at length. Identification, accuracy, etc. Coming to identification, those of us, it is more, when we're talking about the wristbands, it is not so much in the standalone labs where most of the things are from the OPD. But when it comes to hospital practice, then wristband is a very important thing to us. So these are the various things that you look for. You may monitor the error rates, provide immediate feedback about the errors, use staff other than nurses to place the wristband. But it is not so. This is all okay. But here we have a shortage, a chronic shortage always in the hospitals. So we give it to the nurses to place the wristbands, written orders for wristband removal, which we don't do. But we know as a rule that when the patient leaves, it's the last thing to come off. You cannot have a wristband not there because that is the main thing for a patient identification. And report wristband errors to hospital QA committee. Now, I'll give you an important incident which happened. We had a situation where we found, because when we go to do a blood collection, we found that the wristbands of some patients were missing. We were shocked because we had an identification error. So that led us to it. When we looked at it, we didn't find one, we found many. We told the nursing about it. Nursing swore that they have been putting the wristband as per the protocol. We started gathering. We started gathering data from all the phlebotomists who visit the various wards. And sure enough, it was a problem. They would ask the name of the patient, but the wristband was not there. We were wondering, we really went through it with a very fine comb, but we could not locate where the problem is. Then we said, what kind of patients are this? They are not from a single ward. They are not females or males only. And they are not, they are all over the hospital. Then when we started putting, what did they come for? It came boiled down that they were coming for surgery. So all these people who didn't have the wristband were all those who came for surgery. Now, what could have happened? We looked at it. So the nursing swore that when they go, we introduced this to check whether the wristbands were there when they went in to the OT. When they came back, there were no wristbands. So now we know where the problem occurred. And when we asked the anesthetist, where did the wristbands disappear? They said, oh, we cut them. And why? Because we have to get a venous access. So that explained the problem that had occurred. Of course, we then devised another way that now the wristbands are put on either the other hand or on the leg before and never cut. So that was something that we introduced. So that's how we improved the performance. Crew probes, identification error, culture contamination, all of us do that. We had a similar incident as far as the turnaround time of troponin was concerned. The troponins were done day in, day out by the stat lab. It came to our notice, and actually it was a complaint by the doctors and the casualty, that the troponin turnaround times were always increased in the night. We thought our technician must be napping or something, not that they get any time to nap, but what was the result? They were giving it a priority. We all know it has to be done urgently. And what did we find? We looked into it step by step. We called all the night techs also, whoever did the duty. They all said they put it up promptly. Then we looked at what time was it that the troponin T was sent. All those which were sent at 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock in the night were promptly reported. Why did it happen only at 4 o'clock and 5 o'clock in the morning? And we discovered that was a calibration time of the equipment. So the equipment would automatically go for calibration, and that is how the troponins were delayed. Needless to say, we rectified that. So that is how one has to look into the details of it to understand what went wrong. And this is a characteristic of each and every lab. It is not a common characteristic. It is an individual characteristic of the labs. Now, Q probes also, they have done a lot of work in North America. I'm getting a lot of cell disturbance. And this has been done in the pre-analytic, analytic, as well as the three phases in the of the site testing cycle. It was found, and we all know about it, that the maximum number of problems are there in the pre-analytical phase because the lab is not in control of it. And that causes a lot of anxiety to the patients, lab personnel, because we do not know how good the specimen is. And so many years ago, a very enterprising person called Dr. Adarsh Pal Singh, who is unfortunately no more, devised a pre-analytical quality check for improving customer practices. We both worked together so that we enable the customers to identify the problem, a basic pre-analytical specimen compromise. So these were the objectives, to find out where the compromises were, and we could miss out some sample errors. So there was a need for systematic, meticulous, comprehensive pre-analytical quality check program, and that we should quantify these silent compromises which go undetected. It would help the lab in quantifying the pre-analytical issues if they exist, to establish baseline before interventions and to monitor continuous improvement, and also to motivate the employees. So we devised, and actually it was Adarsh who devised, a program which is called, and which I think is still available, May I Help You. It improves customer practices. It's something like a Q-Pro. It will help in identifying gaps in the pre-analytical, and it has got various checkbox to check for patient safety, patient experience, healthcare worker safety, and specimen quality. It will help troubleshoot any existing pre-analytical issue that is there. It would also help in monitoring changes after interventions, training to the phlebotomist, a process can be changed, or a product can be changed. This has been of big help. And I will tell you that this, when we did this exercise, Adarsh and myself, this was an eye-opener for myself, because we do not know what is happening at the accession desk. There were many problems that were occurring, which were silently covered up. In fact, I was horrified when we did this, and we improved on it. The last is the cease testing. This is the end. CAP tells you, please stop. When would they say that? When you have an unsatisfactory PT performance for a regulated analyte. And in the three PT cycles that they send you, there is an initial PT failure. Then it is okay, you need to rectify. It's a failure. So PT one, in first cycle, you got only 20% right. In the second cycle, you got only 100%. You got 100%, and third also you got 100%. So you just have to write a reason what could have gone wrong with documentation, what really went wrong, what you did, and keep it to yourself. And show it to the inspector who comes to see it, because all inspectors, they come with your PT performance. So when they come for the inspection, they ask you, what did you do for this particular PT failure? That's one part of it. When you are unsuccessful in your PT performance, in your unsatisfactory performance for same analyte in three consecutive, if you have all three consecutive and you were graded unacceptable, or two out of three testing events, depending upon the analyte. For if you had even vancomycin, if you out of the three, even if you have two, they will ask you to stop testing. So when a cease testing notice is received, which means you stop testing because you are accredited, CAP does not believe that you are giving the correct result. It means that. So the laboratory director will be asked to sign out an acknowledgement form stating that the patient testing will cease for that particular analyte for 6 months. Regardless of the medical importance, and this becomes very crucial when it comes to blood gas, failure to acknowledge a cease testing notice will result in a revocation of accreditation. Laboratory must provide evidence that they have ceased testing, and it should be shown to the inspectors when they visit you next, which happens once in 2 years. It is effective at an analyte level. So if you have two equipment, say two blood gases, one in the ICU and one in the laboratory, and you are having a same CLI cap number, then you stop cease testing for both. It's very embarrassing to communicate this to the clinicians. Okay, friends, so with that, I end. Thank you.